it is. After a 10-mile walk on the Via Ignatia, Paul arrived here. And below you, spread out beautifully, you see the ruins of that ancient city of Philippi. It takes up almost a whole chapter in the book of Acts, and he writes an entire book to the believers that will come to know Messiah in that city. I think it's just amazing to come and see that. We're on the Acropolis. Not much up here, but a stunning view nevertheless. If you look back towards east, you see more or less the route that the Via Ignatia would have taken. It runs through Philippi as Decumanus. Let me tell you the history of this place. Back way before Paul's time, people from the island of Thasos founded a settlement here called Crenides. But they were harassed by the local Thracian tribes. So in the 300s, mid-300s, they got in touch with a Macedonian king who was west of here a bit, whose name was Philip II. You know him as Alexander the Great's father, and said, come on over and help us with this problem we've got. Philip gladly obliged, and of course, not only came and helped them with the Thasians, but came and basically made the city his own. And either he or his son Alexander, I can find both in the records, changed the name to the city of Philippi. In 168, Rome finally took this as her own. Then comes one of the most significant moments in the history of the world, certainly in the history of the biblical world. In Rome, Rome was ruled by two consuls who served at the same time for 1 year. And then they would change. It was the Roman way to be a republic, so you didn't end up with a king or an emperor like their ancient tribal ancestors had had. Then Julius Caesar does the unthinkable. He wins a victory in Gaul and marches his army right into Rome and demands to be thought of as the king, the ruler. Maybe not called the king, but he basically takes power, realizing, as one author writes, you can have a republic or an empire, but you're not going to have both. And Julius apparently decides he prefers an empire to a republic. Now, there were some who said, no way, we're not going to allow our constitution to go down the drain. We're going to remain a republic. So in March 15 of 44 BC, those republic supporters assassinated Julius Caesar as the Senate met, and Julius was finished. They fled east, Cassius and Brutus, his assassins, and raised an army to come back to Rome to make sure that they remained a republic. Julius's adopted son, Octavian, and one of his greatest generals, Mark Antony, raised an army in Rome and said, no, we will be an imperial empire. And they came marching east to face Cassius and Brutus. They met on the plain of Drama. That battle will determine whether there is an imperial power and an emperor who calls himself the Son of God with a gospel that says, I am the Savior of the world at the time Jesus is born, or whether it will still be a republic. If you look out in the valley, you see two small hills. Picture Mark Antony camped on the left. More than 25,000 Romans. Octavian, who will be Augustus Caesar someday, on the right. Cassius is camped just out of the swamps down here on the left with a huge advantage of the city walls of Philippi. And Brutus at the foot of the hill with the defense of the hill and the city as well. There were two battles, one on October 3 of 42 BC. In that battle, Mark Antony flanked Cassius and cut off his supply route. Cassius was so panicked that he committed suicide, and his part in the whole war ended. Brutus actually defeated Octavian, who ran for his life. The two sides retrenched, and on October 23, Brutus made a fatal mistake. He left the safety of the hill and the city walls and set out to attack his enemy. And he lost. He was given a proper burial and his head sent to Rome and placed at the foot of the statue of Julius Caesar in the Forum. And the world began to change. About 10 years later, 350 miles to the west at a place called Actium, in 31 BC, Octavian and Antony would face off, and you know the story. Octavian, who will be Caesar Augustus, won. Antony fled to Egypt, and with his partner, his friend Cleopatra, committed suicide as well, and Octavian is Lord and God. And the imperial climb to deification begins.